Brandon Cronenberg, the son of body horror extraordinaire David Cronenberg, made my favourite film of 2020, and by the end of this video, I hope I've gone some way as to convincing you why, because it's far from being a movie for everyone. Possessor tells the story of Tessa Voss, an assassin for a mysterious organization that uses a strange technology with the power to possess other people to carry out assassinations without suspicion. For now, I won't say anything about the plot, but I will warn you when I start to indulge in spoilers. Possessor is set in a brooding, enigmatic alternate version of the 21st century. It's minimalistically dystopian and shrouded in a seemingly oppressive Big Brother atmosphere where it begins to blur the line between science fiction fantasy and simply pure realism. As far as its world building is concerned, I like to think of it as the antithesis to Tenet's pretentious overexplaining, where instead of stumbling over itself to desperately seek your validation for its high concepts, Possessor respects the audience's intelligence to willingly suspend their disbelief, put together their own interpretations, and immerse themselves in an eerie, relatable world that truly believes in its own ideas. It's a very modest show-don't-tell experience. Rather than call attention to its concepts with needlessly arbitrary exposition that can easily feel gimmicky, it fragments its information organically within the everyday interactions of characters who live and breathe these weird and speculative concepts as just a normal part of their lives. There's no entry-level explanation for the audience. We are thrown into the midst of it and see this world and its characters through a sinister voyeuristic lens that's indicative of Voss's perspective when she possesses her victims. In fact, I would actually go as far as to compare Possessor's worldbuilding as closer to that of the first John Wick, where the film lets the audience work out the functionality of this world without interrupting the human motive that drives the story. The thing is, Possessor isn't really about the technology and the ins and outs of this ambiguous assassin organization. It's ultimately a story about sociopathy, and to a greater extent, identity dysmorphia. Before we get into the main plot, the core interaction that defines the story is Voss's post-possession psych evaluation with her handler Gerder, a retired assassin looking to unlock Voss's full potential as the ultimate killer. Gerder wants Voss to let go of all her personal attachments to the world, specifically her family, because the small glimmer of empathy Voss is battling with stops her from performing her job to the highest standard. You could say there's a deeper allegory to it regarding the work-obsessed culture that so many of us have fallen into, but I'll come back to that at the end because for now, the point is that Voss's main obstacle isn't so much her target objective, but to overcome her emotional resistance to her brutally violent work. And I mean violent, like seriously, this is unquestionably the most realistically detail-heavy violence I've seen in a movie since Green Room. And I'm not talking about heads exploding or cartoon gore or whatever. This movie makes you feel every shot and every stab by really forcing it upon you in a deliberately provocative way that's necessary to understanding Voss's emotional journey. And no, this is YouTube, so I cannot really show you it. So, going into lighter spoilers, the main story sees Voss take on a contract to assassinate the CEO of a data mining company along with his daughter, so that the client can obtain full control of the company. We're only ever told the necessary details that Voss would need to know to get the job done, but as a side note, it is heavily implied that due to the nature of the company being a data mining farm, the assassin organization seems to have an ulterior motive to gaining control over it because, as we can assume from later scenes, gives the assassins access to personal camera feeds like phones and webcams that would give them even more power to easily achieve their goals. Voss assumes control of Colin Tate, the fiancé to the CEO's daughter, because he's believed to be the ideal candidate to establish a motive for murder, has easy access to both targets, and by following the assassin's procedure of a murder-suicide, removes any suspicion of foul play from the equation. When you think about it, it's surprisingly one of the only fictional depictions of protagonist assassins that actually condemns their actions rather than glorifies them, because sure, while the targets are typically immoral bastards in their own right, Possessor's depiction is especially cold because the people they possess are simply casualties caught in the crossfire of something they know nothing about. As the film goes along, you begin empathizing with Colin, who has no awareness that he's possessed, because his consciousness is suppressed to allow Voss to gain full control, with procedures in place to prevent his consciousness from regaining control. Again, through powerful visuals, we see how Colin's control is stripped away from him, without making Voss completely invincible, because in the event that Colin does regain control, she'll be trapped inside his head. Now, I'm not going to sit and explain every fine detail because it's just super cool to experience it for yourself and come up with your own interpretations for how everything works, but this is where the bigger spoilers come into play. As I said, this is a story about sociopathy and identity dysmorphia, so the film spends most of its time developing the emotionally complicated relationships of both Voss and Colin, until they eventually intersect each other and discover they share many similarities. Voss is established to lose a small piece of herself every time she possesses someone, to the point she has to practice her social interactions to remember how to behave and emote like a normal person. She looks agonizingly withered, and simply struggles to readjust to a boring, unsatisfying, ordinary life. She clearly wants to settle down to get to know her estranged family better, but her work constantly eats away at her, and it's not helped by the fact that her handler Gerda thinks that she should just embrace her dehumanization and become numb to the world to make her a better assassin after failing to successfully self-terminate her previous possession as instructed. During her psyche test, she goes through personal objects that she has to objectively describe to her handler to ensure she's all there, except there is one object that fascinates her, a butterfly she killed and framed as a child, which brings about a subjective feeling of remorse that subsequently symbolizes and explains why she's struggling to kill the people she possesses. Ultimately, she feels bad about it. Her hosts do not deserve to die because they're innocent, and so to combat her emotions in order to become sociopathic, she doesn't actively kill her targets with the company-issued gun she's provided. She instead viciously and violently stabs the ever-loving shit out of them in the most self-indulgent, weirdly curious way possible. That's why I think the film aggressively emphasizes violence. It's not just trying to elicit a response of shock and disgust, but also push you to your limits to make you question how desensitized you really are to violence towards a person who you have no emotional or sympathetic attachment to. This is then contrasted with Colin, who may not be as complex as Voss, but still shares a similar forlorn perspective on the world. Colin is a former drug dealer looking to escape his previous life and benefit from nepotism to rise through the ranks of a career that outwardly can be perceived as respectable against that of a drug dealer, but it's probably a more immoral profession, seeing as well it's a hostile data mining farm. Through subtle worldbuilding, we get a firm grasp of Colin's deeply dissatisfying day-to-day life as he's stuck in a relationship that feels empty and has a turbulent relationship with his future CEO father-in-law as he works as a soulless pawn for a powerful, somewhat mysterious company exploiting unknowing people. A lot of this information is visually mirrored against that of Voss's day-to-day life, as she's also in an empty relationship and soullessly works for a powerful, somewhat mysterious company exploiting unknowing people. Colin and Voss share common experiences, and as Voss gets insight into his world, quickly does she empathize with him, allowing his consciousness to gradually resume control, trapping Voss in his head. Now, before we go any further, from here on out, I'm going to be talking about nothing but major spoilers, so you've been warned. If you want to go watch the film for yourself, please check out the uncut version, and if you don't really care, well, let's get into spoilers. Okay, so by now you're all probably thinking that because Sean Bean is in this and is the target, means he's obviously going to die. Well, ironically, he actually survives, and I think his casting was a very deliberate attempt to subvert those expectations. Although granted, he gets a disgustingly violent battering with a fire poker that includes losing an eye and some teeth, so he doesn't exactly get off scot-free. Anyway, after initiating the assassination, Voss, possessed as Colin, assumedly kills the CEO and his daughter, which is a confirmed kill, and after struggling to self-terminate Colin, mirroring the introduction, Colin is able to fight back and destroy the chip that is implanted in his head in order to possess him. From here, we see the rest of the film through his eyes, as he begins to see visions of Voss fighting back, causing a string of murders in his efforts to find help, resulting in him confronting Voss's consciousness and obtaining her personal memories. Since Voss did not follow her handler's advice to lose her personal attachments, Colin is able to track down her family in a desperate bid to force her out of his head, leading to one of the most harrowing endings I have seen in science fiction since The Mist. The climax intelligently brings the entire film full circle, as Colin confronts Voss's husband Michael and ends up butchering him after an altercation. However, the reality is that Voss has actually regained control of Colin, as implied through Voss's struggles to then self-terminate, resulting in Voss's son Iris stabbing him, causing Voss to then shoot her own son dead, revealing that Ira was possessed by Voss's handler Gerder in order to get Voss back into her own body. In some respects, it's technically a plot twist because Gerder's personal motive was to see Voss surrender her personal attachments and uses her struggles with Colin as an opportunity to basically kill two birds with one stone. Colin is terminated, and Voss is free from not only this guy she's began to self-identify with, but she's let go of the only things left in this world that make her human. The film ends with one final psych evaluation in which Voss returns to the butterfly, a symbol of her empathy. However, this time she doesn't have an emotional response to it, showing that she's finally become the ultimate sociopathic assassin. In fact, the symbol is even powerfully presented as Colin's body rests next to her son's as their blood pools form that of a butterfly. As I said in the opening, Possessor is not a film for everyone, and I wouldn't expect it to be. It's designed to be emotionally conflicting as you question who exactly you're meant to be rooting for. It's a story that shows how important raw emotion truly is to being human. We're lost without it, and become burnt out husks that run on autopilot, too distracted by the world's constant pressure to have time to feel anything. That's why I mentioned the deeper subtext regarding our work-centric society. Many of us have become apathetic or impartial to our existence because we move through life so fast that we rarely, if ever, have time to breathe and soak in the moment. In some respects, our lives are controlled by distractions more than a purpose, and I find Possessor understands that inability many of us have to simply relax or appreciate the things around us. because the moment we stop working or letting these distractions figuratively and literally control us, we regain the consciousness to question who we are.